VoxWave now features a streaming radio media player on our website's front page, where local artists can get their music played 24/7. For more information on getting your music in rotation or to perform live at our studio, contact Reg Gaskins at 240-832-4455.
Android users, the VoxWave app is now available in the Google Play Store. Download the app today on your Android device to listen in and view programs.
Business owners, looking for a place to advertise your business and promote your products and services? VoxWave is the right place. We have over 10,000 views a day and 70,000 listeners a month. For more information, contact Reg Gaskins at 240-832-4455.
The world's number one streaming music station, VoxWave.com.
We have your favorite shows on VoxWave.com. Check out our lineup. The Kim Show, Mondays, 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. In the End We Win with Curtis, Mondays, 8:15 p.m. to 9:15 p.m. Cooking with Flavors with your host, Chef Flavors, Tuesday, 5:30 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. Slick Daddy Rick, Heartbeat Congo Hour, Tuesday, 8 to 10 p.m. Impact the World Radio TV Show with Cheryl Woods, Wednesday, 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. The Digital Digest with your host, Digital Ace, Wednesdays, 3 to 5 p.m. Live Set Wednesdays with your host, Frank Dent, Wednesdays, 8 to 9 p.m. The BGKH Show with your hosts, Dominion and Epic, Wednesdays, 9:15 to 10:15 p.m. You, Math, and Me with George Randall, Thursdays, 10 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. Then, on Thursdays at 5:30 p.m., The Prayer, Praise, and Deliverance with Elder Thurman Gorman Jr. The 6:40 Evening Show, Thursdays, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. The Peace in the Morning Show with your host Darius A. Stan, co-host Delicate Daryl Barnes, and Queen Ayakadobi, Fridays, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. The Hall Street Journal with your host Robert Hall and co-host Clarence Sanders, Fridays, 10:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Frank, The Success Principles, Fridays, 12 noon to 1 p.m. Chanel's 3 Cents, Friday, 1:30 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. The Daryl Allen Harrison II Crime Victims Foundation Show, hosted by Daryl Harrison II, every Friday from 3 to 4:30 p.m. The Rush Hour with DJ Drew and Janique, every Friday from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Different Minds Show, hosted by DJ Bam 640 and DJ Andre Michael, and your co-host, MC Fran, every Friday, 9:15 p.m. to 11:15 p.m. The Healer Blues Show, with host Ron Jackson, every Saturday, 8 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. Hour of Power, with your host, Reverend Winters Rogers, every Saturday, 9:30 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. And again, The Prayer, Praise, and Deliverance with Elder Thurman Gorman Jr., Saturday, 11 p.m. to 12 p.m. And don't forget Four Sisters Live Talk, Saturday at 12:30 to 2:30 p.m. Turning Dreams into Reality Talk Show with your host, Tashika L. Green, every second Saturday, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. Walk in Newness 24/7 with Missionary Antoinette, Saturdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. News, ULM, news and analysis, information, sports, and Black history with your news anchor, Roderick Carter Willis, 4:30 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. Step Your Game Up with The Youth Project, hosted by DJ Main and DJ Lo Jefe, Saturdays, 6:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. And don't miss The To-Go Show with Kim Brown, Saturdays, 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. I Am Dr. Sharon Show, each Sunday from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m., featuring The Grind, Entrepreneur Network Spotlight, and Write the Book Now. The Riri Williams Show, Fashion and Style Hour, every first Sunday from 3 to 4 p.m. Real Talk 101, Sundays, 6 to 8 p.m. And every third Sunday from 3 to 4 p.m., the Third Sunday Tea Talk Show with Dr. Akita Pearson. Gospel Live TV Show with host Gloria Mello, each Sunday from 8:15 p.m. to 9:15 p.m. Listen to all your favorite shows on VoxWave.com.
VoxWave.com.
VoxWave.com, streaming your favorite jazz, blues, and R&B 24/7.
Welcome to Time for a Change with Sherry
and Mickey on.
And we are here live in the studio, and you cannot see all of the guests that we have in the studio tonight, but we have a live show for you tonight. We have candidates that are running for county positions, and you need to be involved. I say all the time, get involved. I don't care where, get involved. And this is where it all begins, right here on the local level. Am I right?
Absolutely. We definitely have to know who our local candidates is. A lot of people only come out when that big presidential election, but then they always want to know what's going on in their community. So these are the people that's here today that's going to let you know what's going on in your community.
Exactly. So if you have any questions, or you hear anybody that you would like to, you'd like to ask any questions, make sure that you pick up the phone and call. It's 240-719-2560. Again, that's 240-719-2560. So we're going to go ahead and get started because, like we all know, we usually do our In the News segment. But, of course, our candidates are busy, busy, busy. And this is a busy time for them and they have to leave. So we're going to go ahead and get started with our candidates. And let's start with, we have Aisha Braveboy here to my right, former state delegate. Now running for state's attorney.
Yes.
Welcome to the Time for Change show.
Thank you so much for having me, but really all of us, because it's really going to take all of us working together to move this county in a better direction.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Well, go ahead and tell us a little bit about what you're doing and
sure.
what you're writing.
Sure, absolutely. Well, as was mentioned, I'm a former state delegate. I grew up here in Prince George's County, went to Largo High School for all the
Ooh,
Lions in the house.
Oh, we love that!
So there's some Lions in the house. And then I went on to the University of Maryland at College Park and then Howard University for mm-hmm. law school. So there's my fellow Bison.
Oh, yay, yeah. Howard!
Oh, Howard, I was blessed to serve the county in the 25th district as a state delegate for 8 years. I was also fortunate enough to receive the confidence of my peers and was elected to be the chair of the Legislative Black Caucus, which I served for 2 years. And now I'm running for state's attorney for Prince George's County. The state's attorney is the top prosecutor in the county, the top law enforcement officer. Okay. And I look forward to addressing some of the big issues that are affecting us. I know you're going to get into that. So that's my introduction. But if you want me to get into a couple of things that
if
I want to address.
If you have a few more minutes, I'm
going
to let a couple more
Keep it flowing. Absolutely.
All right. So we also have Don Juan Williams with us tonight. And Don Juan, let me tell you, I met him. He was the mayor of Glen Arden, a good friend of my family, and wow. And now you're running for state delegate, District 24.
Yes.
So welcome to Time for a Change. Can you tell us about your platform and where you and the position you're running for?
Thank you very much for having me here. Thank you. Oh, grab the mic. That's right. Thank you very much for having me here and getting everyone else here. This is a true platform, and I guess we really need this. So I applaud you. I'm Don Juan, DJ Williams. I am raised in this county, went to Eleanor Roosevelt, the smart school. In Glen Arden. First tech school in Glen Arden. Okay. So I graduated there, and I went on to Salisbury University. I majored in political science, then went on to Bowie State. And I had my master's in public administration and human resources management. I've been in the military for 28 years. I retired, chief warrant officer. I'm an expert in transportation, and one of the main issues in this state is transportation. I've been a three-term mayor. Matter of fact, they passed a law in Glen Arden that if you're a three-term mayor, you can never run for mayor again. Don Juan Williams law to get it, stop me from ever running for mayor again. So I'm back on the council. I'm on my fourth term as a council because I got back on the council to change that law. So I got back on the council. So I'm a basketball referee, college, high school. AAU, little kids. Matter of fact, the military, I'm doing the championship game tomorrow at the barracks at 11 o'clock at 8th and I. Mm-hmm. I'm a Cap Alpha Psi life member. Mm-hmm. I'm in two chapters. I started the Bowie, I'm one of the charter members that started Bowie Mitchellville chapter in Hinesville, Landover. Matter of fact, we just had 162 people go over this weekend.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
Yeah.
And I can go on and on and on and on, but it's it's not all about me. I know it's a little about me. So.
Real quick, though, tell me what the state delegate position.
I'm running for the position that Ms. Braveboy used to have.
Okay.
It's a state legislature. You think of Congress. There's 435 members in Congress. And the House of Representatives, there's 141 in state. So we do they do the same thing you do, the Congress does, but you do it on the state level.
State
pass
level.
Laws, legislation, and override vetoes, same thing.
Awesome.
Awesome.
Thank you for joining us.
Mm-hmm. My pleasure.
Mm-hmm. And of course, we have Juan Stewart in the and live in the studio. He's running for County Council, District 7. Hello, Juan. Thank you for joining us at Time for Change.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. It's a pleasure to be here amongst such distinguished guests. My name is Juan Stewart, as you mentioned. I'm a candidate for County Council in District 7. The County Council is the legislative branch of the Prince George's County government. They serve as the Board of Health as well as District Council for zoning matters. Mm-hmm. A little bit about myself. I'm 30 years old. I graduated from Georgetown in 2010. Prior to that, I graduated from Bladensburg High School. So I'm a world-class Mustang. I'm a world-class Mustang. And I grew up all over the county predominantly in a lot of apartment complexes growing up. And after college, I was afforded the opportunity to purchase a home in my community where I grew up. And that right there is what got the ball rolling with me getting more civically involved. Mm-hmm. And I just decided to roll up my sleeves and be an example for young black men like myself, who so often, you go around this country, you find a lot of folks from Prince George's. And they're doing big things. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to be the example of the folks that's doing big things, but chose to stay right here in my community.
That's right.
Absolutely.
That's right.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your service.
Oh, thank you.
And he always comes out to the Civic Association meetings, and we love that. So
most definitely. Yeah, I love my civic meetings. I get to engage with the old, the young.
The old and young.
Exactly. And they got a lot of questions and a lot of energy.
They do,
don't
they?
Yes, indeed.
So, next we have
Tamara
Davis Brown, running for County Council, District 9.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us at Time for Change.
Thank you for having us all again as delegate. Brave Boy said, State's Attorney, I'm going to speak it.
Oh, there you go, State's Attorney, yes.
Thank you, Council.
It takes all of us to work together to make Prince George's County the best county that it can be. And we know that the county has the potential to do great things for all of its residents. And we don't want to leave anyone behind, whether it's a single mother, whether you're a family, working class family, whether you are a single father, whether you are a teen, whatever. We want to make sure that Prince George's County offers the best for all of us. And, we always talk about and you hear about the potential. But I want to thank you guys for having us. Again, I'm Tamara Davis Brown. I'm running for Prince George's County Council, District 9. Now, District 9 is the southernmost portion of Prince George's County. It is actually the largest in land mass of all the districts. However, it's mostly the more rural portions. It covers alphabetically, if I can get it right, Accokeek, Owasco, Baden, Brandywine, Sheltenham, Clinton, Croom, Marwood, Melwood. Did I say Brandywine?
Mm-hmm.
Brandywine. It includes portions of Fort Washington as well.
Okay.
On the east side of 210 near Friendly High School, off of Old Fort Road in Fort Washington Forest. Okay. It also includes other communities in Upper Marlboro. I already mentioned Croom and Sheltenham, but Malton. All the way up to including the town of Upper Marlboro. So it's a big area land mass wise, but population wise, because it's still very rural and undeveloped. And so a lot of the issues that deal with in District 9 have to do with zoning. And so you'll find that the residents are very concerned about how we are building out the county and how it's going to affect us, whether it's road congestion, traffic, which is a big issue down there, because you've got a lot of Charles County, St. Mary's, and Calvert County residents driving through our main corridors, Route 5, Route 4, Route 210, 301, coming through to get to their destinations, either in D.C., Virginia, or Montgomery County. So those are some of the big issues for them, but the building, making sure that we have adequate education facilities, building new facilities, rebuilding facilities for our kids to have 21st century schools for our students. Those are really big issues as well. And so also they're looking to have greater economic development there. So those are some of the issues that the folks in District 9 are concerned about, and I've been working on them tirelessly for the last over a decade or so. One of the things that distinguishes me from the other candidates is that I've been active and involved for a very long time, working with, for, and advocating for the community on a lot of the zoning issues, particularly, as well as other issues, education and so forth. So look forward to continuing the discussion today.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
We are definitely going to talk more because you'll be able to stay with us after some of the other candidates have to leave. But so we have Crystal Orieva.
Oh, perfect.
Perfect. Yay. Welcome to Time for a Change.
Thank you for having me.
Definitely.
So I'm running for County Council for District 7. Mm-hmm. And for me, I've been a political advocate for a little over a decade. Everyone says you're so young, but I started young. Mm-hmm. And it's because I really believe the only way you can change your community is by doing the hard work.
Absolutely.
And for me, I did my undergrad at Howard University. I went on, and I went on to get my MBA. And I worked in corporate America for a little bit and doing nonprofit on the side. And I realized that I really wanted to give everything to that. Mm-hmm. And corporate America wasn't fulfilling me. Mm-hmm. And people thought I was crazy because I worked at Hewlett Packard. I was a global project manager, so running the divisions for if we were moving a product to like Africa or Asia, all over the world, what that would look like. Mm-hmm. And so I walked away from that because I knew that I had the skill and talent, but I was giving it to a corporation that was just making more money and not to people, and I could change their lives.
Absolutely.
And so I started working as a consultant, doing work for the federal government around domestic violence, human trafficking, adolescent pregnancy prevention. Mm-hmm. And then also I'm the communications director for a nonprofit that works on how can we break the pipeline from school to prison. Mm. And I've been doing that for 4 years.
Yes.
And I've been doing that job pro bono because they couldn't afford me at the rate that I get paid doing consulting work for the federal government. And that, to me, just, I would say if you want to know a politician that's running for office and see where their heart lies, ask them what they've been doing with their life. Mm-hmm. And that shows you where they're going. A glimpse into their past shows you the path of their future. And for me, I decided a long time ago that I wanted to dedicate my life to service. And the reason I decided to run, even though I've been in the background for a long time, working as a fellow with the Obama campaign, the Hillary campaign, loving just doing grassroots, but not minding not doing it for myself, is because I realized that we don't have a lot of advocates and activists at the table.
Okay, mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's what's missing. Mm-hmm. The people that do this work for no name recognition,
mm-hmm.
no accolades, no money. Mm-hmm. No money. Say that again. No money. Just the people that would be willing to fight and shout and do whatever it takes to get the legislation across the line. Because mm-hmm. I've worked on policy and we're sitting in the room and we're working and I think we're on the same page and then we leave and it comes back to committee and it's completely different.
Mm-hmm.
And I have no control over that. All I could do was lobby in that moment for what I believed it should look like. And I think once you have advocates and activists in office, then they can push it all the way across the finish line.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, education, economic development, and quality of life are things I want to push. Pre-K for all, community schools, fair living wages, food deserts in our community, because I live in Sea Pleasant where we don't have access to we don't have access to food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so sometimes you'll see people already here talking about maybe environmental issues like the plastic bag tax, which is great when you're there. We don't have food to put in a plastic bag, so we're not there.
You're not worried about that.
And so I think that I want to be that voice that can talk about what issues are prevalent to my district in District 7.
That's right.
I'm excited about this platform. I'm excited just to even push the issues. I think win, lose, draw, what's so great about what's going on right now is you have a lot of activists and advocates that are making and forcing people as candidates to talk about the things that really matter.
That's right. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you. Service. This is amazing. I'm so excited. Okay, so now we have Benita
Rabelais.
Benita Rabelais in live in the studio, and she is running for clerk of circuit court, District 24. Am I supposed to add that?
Prince George's County.
For Prince George's County.
Yes.
Okay, it's for Prince George's County.
Welcome.
Well, thank
you
all. Thank you again for the invitation. I am a first-time candidate. I am. I have over 25 years of legal administrative experience. Mm-hmm. I am a mother of three. I have spent my career working in the administrative legal field. I've raised my three children, all three college graduated, so I can say a lot of things, but I have three very well-educated young adults. Mm-hmm. So that's what I've spent my career doing. I've worked as a clerk in various clerk's offices, so I've grown up in the administrative legal field. Mm-hmm. And like I said, for 25 years, I did that while raising my children. So I come to this place in my life with nothing else. I come with experience. Mm-hmm. I come to the clerk's office with experience. Awesome. And I, as clerk, I would bring that experience and continue what has started there at where it is now with this present administration that, you know, that's there. I would continue to build on those very important things of quality, professional customer service. The residents of Prince George's County deserve top quality service. They deserve patience. When you come to the clerk's office, mm-hmm. most times you're at very vulnerable mm-hmm. times in your life. Mm-hmm. And to come to that window and meet a clerk that is willing, ready, and able to help you mm-hmm. professionally with knowledge of what it is you'll need. Mm-hmm. And when you leave that, and when you leave that clerk's office, it is vital that you leave there with your questions answered, not feeling frustrated, not feeling that you've gotten the runaround, mm-hmm. because you know, honestly, the courthouse is a very intimidating atmosphere.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, like I said, when you come there, you're usually in a vulnerable place, and you don't come there with a lot of information. You come with a lot of questions, mm-hmm. and it's very important that you have your questions answered, and you feel comfortable with what it is you've come there to receive.
So, absolutely.
As a clerk myself, I understand what it takes to do the position. As a manager, I understand what it takes to manage the clerks to get them to that point. I understand that training of clerks is very important. Mm-hmm. And so professional training is very important to me. It happened for me, and it can happen for them.
Well, thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you for explaining that, because I really wanted to know what the position entailed. So thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
So quickly, before our candidates that do have to leave, would you guys like to share any more information or anything, how we can get in contact with you or how people can help you on your campaign trail? Is there anything that you want to share before you leave?
Yeah, I wanted to share something, and I'm sure that Tamara will talk about it a little bit more when she gets into some of the things that she's doing. But, you know, every year about 20 to 30% of our homicides are domestic, mm-hmm. and so many of them involve children, mm-hmm. babies. I work at Children's National, and we have seen an increase not only in the number of children who come to us with trauma, but the severity mm-hmm. of their injuries, and sometimes we can't save them. Mm-hmm. And that is the most difficult thing when a precious child loses his or her life, especially when it's at the hand of a parent mm-hmm. or a caregiver. And so it is, you know, it's with that in mind that I have to say that, you know, the job of not just the next state's attorney, which I hope I earn the support of the community to become the next state's attorney, but all of us in this room, it is our responsibility to make domestic violence mm-hmm. a priority.
Absolutely.
And you know, my job will be to prosecute individuals who are committing the abuse, but we won't be able to successfully prosecute individuals if we don't have cooperating witnesses. Mm-hmm. And so the victims are often the witnesses mm-hmm. and the only witnesses. Mm-hmm. And so we need them to be safe We need them to believe that they can live independent of their abuser. Mm-hmm. And the only way we're going to do that is by providing transitional housing mm-hmm. That is comfortable for them to live as a family unit.
Absolutely. Right?
Shelters, survey purpose, but a very temporary purpose. Mm-hmm. Yes, we need to have permanent transitional housing for individuals. We need to have counseling, mental health. We don't have an inpatient treatment, really, mm-hmm. except if you have an acute need and you go to Prince George's Hospital. Right. But we don't have inpatient facilities for people who need it. We don't have enough outpatient facilities also for individuals who need it. And we don't talk about it enough mm-hmm. because it's real. And then we need to also be able to provide financial assistance so people can, you know, just have the basics that they need in order to survive. That's going to take the council. It's going to take the folks in the clerk's office mm-hmm. to make sure that these, you know, domestic orders and protective orders are, you know, issued quickly, given to the sheriff's department. It's just going to take everyone, and you know, even at the state level, we may need additional funding at the state level for housing and tax credits for those developers and apartment owners mm-hmm. who are willing to provide transitional housing. We want to give them an incentive to do it. So we all have to work together. This is an issue that we can do something about. We must do something about it. It literally is a matter of life or death.
Absolutely. Literally. I am a domestic violence advocate. I have been an advocate for 11 years. Also started my organization doing that, and you're absolutely right. When it comes to domestic violence, it's going to take everybody coming together mm-hmm. to play their part. Even with more on your side for legislation, I have had this thing in my head because I am a former victim of domestic violence
survivor.
As well. Mm-hmm. Yes, I am a survivor now, mm-hmm. yes. Mm-hmm. But when I was in my situation, mm-hmm. and, you know, when I didn't know how to get out, and there were so many people around, the enablers. Mm-hmm. And so I'm looking at it, you know, a lot of times when it came to the schools, when children was missing a lot of days, when they started holding the parents accountable, mm-hmm. and then it changed. And now they're even looking at holding the parents accountable, that's the bullies, the parents of bullying. So they're looking at to hold them accountable. So I was thinking, wouldn't the same thing work if we were to hold accountable the enablers? Say, like, for instance, if there is a domestic violence situation in your home and you're not doing anything about it, and then someone ends up murdered, like my daughter did. She was inside her boyfriend's home where there was known violence going on, that we should be able to hold those people accountable as well.
You know, domestic violence, though, is a it's a very complex issue. It really is, and often people who have been victimized, it is really difficult for them to speak up mm-hmm. for themselves. Sometimes it's also, unfortunately, they don't speak up for their children either, and it's not because they don't want to. It's that they literally feel like they can. It mm-hmm. is a cycle of violence, and it puts those who are victimized in a position of feeling like they're nothing, mm-hmm. and the abuser breaks them down mm-hmm. so much, and so to then, you know, maybe want to, you know, place some, you know, onus on them or penalize them. May not be the direction that's best to go in because it really is an issue that we don't want to blame the victim mm-hmm. essentially mm-hmm. And when you're in that state, you really aren't making rational choices. Mm-hmm. You're just existing, mm-hmm. And that's why I think it's so important for us to have options for people so that. If we have a situation where there's a violence occurring in a home, that mother, which is primarily women who are victims, not always, but primarily, can say, you know what, I can leave tonight, I can take my children with me, mm-hmm. and I have a home for them mm-hmm. to stay in. And I think that will give people the reassurance they need that they can leave, they can seek help. I think that is the better option, providing more resources, providing more choices, than necessarily penalizing them. Mm-hmm.
But then before our younger young men and women we have to have the village mentality. Mm-hmm. We're responsible for one another. Mm-hmm. And if we don't say something, then we lose somewhere. Mm-hmm. If your child is in a home and someone else knows that your child is being abused or mm-hmm. just not, your son or daughter is just not being treated with the respect, we as parents and caregivers and aunts and uncles have to step up and say, you're not treating him or her right.
Right. Mm-hmm.
This is not right. Mm-hmm. This is not right. Mm-hmm. And not be afraid that abuser is going to turn on them. We have to be the village. Mm-hmm. And we have to take the violence out of our homes and out of our neighborhoods.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
I totally agree with that. I think a lot of us, as just regular human nature is to avoid violence, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So when you see someone portraying that image and you see someone who is violent, your automatic instinct is to avoid the violence.
To retreat.
It's not my instinct to go help.
Right.
My instinct is to get
retreat.
Away from the violence. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we definitely have to have that open conversation like we do mm-hmm. with people about if you are the bystander training. Mm-hmm. How do you approach a situation? Mm-hmm. How do you address a situation when someone is going through that situation? You know, with that whole lipstick movement that they have, with mm-hmm. the lipstick movement, mm-hmm. that was a great way to start addressing things. But, you know, we just have to have these conversations so that we can start informing people on how to be that bystander, mm-hmm. right? Because, unfortunately, a lot of times, I was in a Rite Aid one time, and a man was getting really violent with the young lady over in Largo. Mm-hmm. The fighter in me, for this whole cause, wanted to say something mm-hmm. to him, but I knew that I couldn't mm-hmm. because either I was going to make it worse for her or I was going to get turned on me. Mm-hmm. So I had to kind of just stand in the background and I could hear him, and I just let him know that I'm here, I hear you. Mm-hmm. I stood right in the aisle, I never left. I can hear you, I see you. Mm-hmm. But I didn't say anything.
Right.
You know, eventually she did give in to him and they left mm-hmm. out the building. Mm-hmm. But I did give her that eye, like, are you okay? At mm-hmm. any time, just mm-hmm. let me know.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So we just have to, it's different.
It's tough. Mm-hmm.
It's different.
And I think you also have to, as the community and family that see those things happening, mm-hmm. have a level of compassion. Because
mm-hmm.
I've seen and lived in some experiences where one side was saying, well, I'm going to just block their phone number. I told them to leave. They're not leaving. This is the last time, and I'm cutting off all communication with them. Mm-hmm. And you're punishing the person that's in that circumstance. Mm-hmm. And there was a lack of compassion.
Right, yeah.
And then that just feeds what that person has been telling them, that no one else is here
yeah,
for you
absolutely.
But me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I try to explain to them that you have to love them and mm-hmm. care for them through it.
Yes.
And be the person that's always going to pick up the phone, mm-hmm. always is going to show up, no matter what. Mm-hmm. And I understand, like, that fear of that moment of you're not sure how that's going to end up.
Mm-hmm.
And I usually don't talk about personal experiences for myself in that, but I think sometimes you have to do that so people can understand the realness of that mm-hmm. and that it happens on every level with every type of person. Mm-hmm. And for me, someone in my family, that happened, and I stepped in, and I was young, still in high school, didn't really understand the severity of that moment. And I ended up with my jaw broken and wired shut, mm-hmm. and the person still went back to them.
Mm-hmm.
And that damaged our relationship for a little bit because I was too young to understand why. Do they love them more than me? Do they care for them more than me? But I had to let that go and mm-hmm. love them through that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. absolutely, absolutely.
Don Juan, I know you want to say something, so go ahead.
Well, I was a social worker for 12 years. So I saw a lot of things as a CPS worker and a foster care worker. Mm-hmm. So it's good that you had a good discernment. Because even as a worker, now, I see somebody being abused. You're supposed to talk to them and then nothing, give them papers, take the child, and then come to court the next day. If you're not trained to do that, mm-hmm. it's not worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I wanted to stay here longer, but I have a city council meeting that they're paying me to be at. So this is not being paid. So I have to get to where my job is tonight.
Right.
But I did want to leave people who are interested in following my campaign. It's DJ Williams for delegate.com is my website. And the number is 240-413-1566. I want to leave everyone with some of my core issues. One is I wanted legislation to be in place for elderly people to age in place. Mm-hmm. Too often now, we have people who, and I'm getting up there, and I applaud all the younger people who are running, because I started a city councilman when I was 26, and then mayor when I was 33. So I encourage you, I applaud you, and don't let anybody stop you. Even if you don't win this time, keep it going. Keep hope alive, because mm-hmm. you are our future.
Yes.
Age in place, meaning that for those who don't know what aging in place means, is that right now we give vouchers to young families and mothers for housing. Mm-hmm. Why don't we change the paradigm and give vouchers to seniors who are paid so they can stay in their place?
Yeah.
Don't have to go to a senior citizen mm-hmm. home, because a lot of them don't want to do that.
Yeah.
They want to live in their own homes, but they can't afford because they lost their income. Mm-hmm. Thinking out the box, that's what I want to do. I also want health care for everybody in the state. Mm-hmm. So that if that means a single payer system, mm-hmm. let it be so. Mm-hmm. We need to take the profit out of health care.
Mm-hmm.
Got all these people making money off of everybody's mm-hmm. unwellness.
Mm-hmm.
Think about this. You go to the grocery store, mm-hmm. the foods that will kill you are cheap.
Mm-hmm.
The That's ones right. that will keep you alive are expensive.
Yes.
That's right.
Something wrong with that picture.
Mm-hmm.
That healthy foods are expensive.
That's right.
Candy, junk food is inexpensive.
That's right.
I'm not saying it's a conspiracy. I'm not saying it. But think about this. Somebody wants you to be sick more than they want you to be healthy.
Absolutely.
Better education for our youth,
yeah.
but not just spending money.
Mm-hmm.
I'm advocated to change the paradigm again. I believe that we have in this county two boards that are appointed and have taxing authority, WSSC, parking planning. The county executive appoints them, they have taxing authority. We got a school board that elected and don't have taxing authority.
Mm-hmm.
Something wrong with that picture.
Mm-hmm.
If you go around the country, most school boards have taxing authority. Why we don't have that in Prince George's County? Mm-hmm. And more importantly, I think we ought to have elected and not a hybrid system that the county executive take over and the CEO is not accountable to the school board.
Mm-hmm.
That's a problem, because now that county executive, CEO is only answering to the person who gave that person the job.
Right.
And that leads me to another issue
that's
that I just found
out.
That's a whole nother issue. But this bring breakfast to the classroom is totally wasting a lot of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't know about it, ask one of the school teachers or administrators that everyday cafeteria workers bring all this food to the classroom, and half the students don't even eat it, wasting milk, wasting food, and they throw it away in the trash because they can't bring it back and refrigerate the milk or the fruit cups or the fruit.
Mm-hmm.
So we got millions of dollars being thrown away all countywide. So before we keep asking for money, we need to be good stewards of the money that we're giving to them.
Absolutely.
And I'm a warrant officer, chief warrant officer in the military, retired. Transportation I'm an expert in all modes of transportation. We need to do something about our traffic.
Mm-hmm.
Beltway, horrendous. 1 and 2 o'clock, back up on the Beltway every day now. Didn't used to be that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm suggesting giving tax credit for more teleworking. Purple line. We got to change paradigm. And that's not going to happen by just thinking, doing the same thing over and over. Throwing money at a problem. It's not necessarily the money, it's how you spend the money. So those are some of the things that I wanted to just throw out here, let people know what I'm about. I've been fighting for this country for 28 years overseas and on this earth, in this country. Now I'm ready to fight for you all up in Annapolis. I thank you, Sherry, for giving me this opportunity, this
you're
platform
welcome.
To address my...
Thank you for coming.
And you're welcome. Everyone here, much success. And again, I'm proud to see the younger people out here running. It makes me feel good because when I was running, they kept telling me, no, you need to wait your time, wait your time.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, who made y'all the timekeeper?
Yes.
You know, so don't let... Pay your dues. Well, you can pay them, and they still won't choose you.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a political county, and if you ain't in the right place, then you're on the outside. So you got to fight a little harder. So, but I'm saying, don't give up the fight. Keep hope alive. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
We're going to go ahead and talk to Juan Stewart real quick, because I know you have to leave as well. So we'll go ahead and talk to you real quick, and then we'll go to our break.
Yes, I'll make it brief as possible. Mm-hmm. So a couple of my core issues. I believe the number one issue in the county is food. I think food speaks to the socioeconomic disparity that we have outside the Beltway versus inside the Beltway.
Oh, yeah.
We have two coalition meetings that I attend as often as I can make them within my district and one outside. And I find it very interesting that they have the same issue. Grocery stores, right? So on one issue, one meeting outside the Beltway, the grocery store problem is we have too many grocery stores. We don't want another food line in Bowie. We don't want another Harris Teeter. I'll let the folks know.
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, so we have too many grocery stores outside the Beltway. And then that same coalition comes inside the Beltway, and the question is, why don't we have enough grocery stores? And you know, it's the same people in the room a lot of times, but the issue is on opposite sides of the coin. And so I believe that we need better equity, more I guess you could say more vibrant and more hybrid ideas to get more access to nutritious food inside the Beltway, especially in our border, the city that border the district. I live in Capitol Heights, about 20 feet from the district line. And within a mile of me, there are about, I want to say, 9 liquor stores and about 12 carryouts.
Mm-hmm.
However, I only have one grocery store. And that grocery store oftentimes has bad meat, the bread is going to expire tomorrow, you know, and no milk often. And and this is a good one. You have aluminum foil that's $10. And I asked the manager, why is it so expensive? And she tells me, you should go shop up the street. We charge a lot for our products because we have so much theft. Mm-hmm. So because of the theft, we have to make the margin somewhere. So it's either that or we close the store. And so a lot of times you have people who are most vulnerable getting, I guess you could say, taxed, really, because of things that are a bit out of their control.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that as the a leader within my community and on the county council, I would first do my part in doing a needs assessment. And with that needs assessment, getting it published and getting it on the record and letting folks know that In our most vulnerable communities, health isn't being taken serious because what we put in our body ultimately determines, you know, our quality of life. Because I believe that health is wealth.
Yes,
I don't care
is.
How much money you have.
Mm-hmm.
If you ain't feeling well, it
don't
matter.
It means nothing. It means absolutely
so. And then also the youth engagement. I remember I served on the I was student member of the board. I was treasurer for student member of the board. When I was in high school, and I was literally all over the county, from Bladensburg, you know, I was going to Roosevelt, Gwynn Park, Douglas, and I never knew how the county worked. I received $300,000 in total from Georgetown, and I went there, and I remember writing a lot of my the delegates and not delegates, the politicians that were in my community as the class president. We had to staff the stage for the graduation. And I wrote all these people, and none of them showed up.
Mm.
All right? Mayor Walter James did from Bladensburg.
I know Mayor Walter
James. Yeah, Mayor Walter James
yes.
did. He gave my commencement speech.
Mm.
And I remember going to Georgetown, And then getting there, and I would look from the top of the our clock tower, you can see over in Prince George's County. And I realized that the people that I was attending school and getting this higher education, they knew nothing about what was going on literally 10-15 minutes away. Mm-hmm. So I just want to I want to really be the beacon for our young people and let them know that if you get civically engaged, you can be that person who brings that be the good peer pressure. Mm-hmm. We have so much bad peer pressure in our communities. So I really want to help start that wave and get more. We need book clubs inside the Beltway. Mm-hmm. We need folks to understand their history. Without knowing where you came from, you cannot know where you're going. And lastly, I'll say that the community development, I shouldn't see mattresses on our streets, like whole bedroom sets sitting out on state highways. We have to get a program in place in order to make our community beautiful.
Right.
Because when I go outside the Beltway, I don't see those things. The streets turn from cement or concrete to asphalt outside the Beltway. So I want to really own in on those issues, knowing that it may take 20 years to get them all fixed, right, to see that progress. However, we have to recognize that they're there because I noticed that us not recognizing issues that affect folks that live in our communities is a lot like us not recognizing those people that live there.
Yeah.
And then we want them to come out and vote for us, want them to show up to our forums and things like that. And they look at us like we're crazy because how you want me to come out here and show support for you when you were elected to bring solutions and you've brought none?
Right.
So I really, those are the things that are most important to me. In addition to bringing the jobs to the community. I want to say one last thing. I had a question posed to me at one of my civic meetings. And they were asking about, she said, why all those cars from the apartment complexes? You know, can we do something about the cars? They parking all in the community, outside. They running over the apartment complexes, right? Mm-hmm. And they didn't let me speak at this because it was supposed to be apolitical. So I want to address that in... That's not a lot. She was saying it was a zoning issue, you know, the county council shit. And yeah, that may play a part, but I see that as more of a jobs and economic issue. Mm-hmm. We have people living 7, 8, 9, 10 to an apartment nowadays, as opposed to a house.
Oh yeah.
So when you have that, you got these people with cars, and they got to get back and forth to work to make the rent because within District 7, you can. Around me, there are 4 apartment complexes for a 3-bedroom apartment. It's like $1,700, right? And that's more than the mortgage in most of the houses that are around me, right?
Okay.
So it's that right there. So we got to find a way to get more jobs to the community so that people don't have to, live that many to a house because that right there puts the stress and the thing brings things to the home that we don't need, which, in my opinion, points to other coping mechanisms that are around us.
Right.
So that right there is some of the things I wanted to share about my campaign and platform. And I really would like everyone to reach out to me. I'm at juanstewartjr.com or Juan for PG7 on social media.
Well, thank you so much, Juan. I appreciate you for coming out. And Juan was one of the pillars in us not getting that 7-Eleven over in Capitol Heights. I'm so excited. They were thinking about putting a 7-Eleven. You remember where Citizens Bank used to be? Mm-hmm. And they turned it into a church. So now it's like a church right behind the Shell gas station at Martin Luther King and
Sheriff
Road.
Okay.
They were thinking about putting a 7-Eleven there with gas pumps, with the full gas station. Why?
When there's 3
other gas stations sitting right there, and there's a 7-Eleven right up the hill. Like, why? Mm-hmm. And then you want to do all of these studies on us to tell us how unhealthy we are and how overweight we are. But you want to put a 7-Eleven.
And
it was just ridiculous.
And to that particular issue, that wasn't because we're pro-business, right? We all want businesses to thrive in our community. Mm-hmm. However, that was an issue of zoning.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I recall correctly, it was found that if they could have, there was a zoning workaround, if you will, to allow them to get beer, to be able to sell.
Right.
I get an alcohol license in the gas station without having to review it as you would if they were able to get a set aside or
something like that.
Yeah, it was like a so they that was a zoning issue. And they sidestepped the community, you know, in order to get this gas station to the zoning board,
mm-hmm.
and those things like that, it should have been taken to, I believe, within a 10-mile radius. Any new convenience stores should be reported to the civic associations, and we mm-hmm. got it once they were in the planning stages. They had, you know, started ordering stuff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you know.
They were ready to break ground.
Wow.
And now all of a sudden you're telling us that we're going to get a new 7-Eleven. That's just like the new liquor store we got. So now we have four liquor stores.
Yeah.
One, mm-hmm. two, three. And the 7-Eleven sells liquor.
Yes,
but
exactly.
They sell beer and wine.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we have like four locations in the immediate area.
Mm-hmm.
With no grocery store.
With mm-hmm. no grocery store.
Yeah, that's
because you can't go in Shoppers and trust it. Lord have mercy. Can't trust it. Not at all.
Well, I thank you guys for having me, Sherry.
Thank you.
As you know, I'm only a phone call or a text message away. I have to get to, actually, I'm going to a food farmer's market meeting. So
okay.
I promised them I would be there tonight. So that's where I'm headed. So you have my number, and please invite me back. I would love to see the candidates after the election.
Okay.
You know, give me some time to take a vacation. Or uh-huh. I want to see all the candidates back after the election, because I think that it's good to keep this thing going,
so
that when, you know, things happen, things occur, we know who mean well by it.
Right.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Definitely. We'll definitely do that. So we're going to take a quick break here at Time for a Change. We'll be right back with Time for a Change with Sherry.
And Mickey on.
Hello, how are you? Can you play the
why can't we live together? you're still my brother. I said no matter, no matter what color, you are still my brother. Everybody wants to live together. Why can't we live together?
Time for a change with Sherry
and Mikyon,
and of course today we've had a very awesome show. We have live in the studio candidates that are running for local election here in Prince George's County, and a couple of people had to leave because we know that you guys are busy, right? But yes, we still have a few people here in the studio with us, so we're going to go back to our conversation. Okay,
sure.
So we have Miss Tamara. And we have Miss Bonita.
Right.
Okay. I'm trying to remember stuff because my brain, I'm just, I'm such a scatterbrain. But, you know, we had earlier conversations and people were talking about their platforms and different things that they would like to stand for and fight for. I know you gave us a little bit earlier.
Sure.
But was there any comments that you wanted to make?
Sure. Her? And just picking up on a couple of things, especially from Aisha Braveboy, as well as Mr. Stewart, when they were here, in terms of women's rights, you see on my platform, I actually focus on women's rights here in Prince George's County, and what I really want to do, and Aisha, when she said that I would probably talk more on this, because I always believe in not just talking about what the problems are. We want to come up with decent and doable solutions. And so one of the things that I've proposed and want to do as the next councilwoman for District 9 is to make sure that we take advantage of the fact, unfortunately, we were hit very hard in 2008 with the housing foreclosure crisis. And we still have a number of homes in our county that are still in foreclosure, going through the foreclosure system. Bonita can probably tell you this from working in the clerk's office, but also homes that are just sitting empty. And yeah. we talked about good transitional housing. Mm-hmm. And this can not only work for victims of domestic violence, but also for people who need affordable housing,
yeah.
Our veterans, mm-hmm. Folks that are just at a vulnerable stage. But a lot of people do not know that the state attorney general's office under Doug Gansler at the time, now Brian Frosch, settled a lawsuit that dealt with the foreclosure crisis mm-hmm. Against Bank of America, Countrywide, as well as Wells Fargo. And Prince George's County got a bulk of those settlement funds because we were the hardest hit county in the state, mm-hmm. even in the nation in terms of home foreclosure. Mm-hmm. And so what the current administration has done is to use some of those funds for first-time home buyer programs, and I certainly support that. But however, we still need that transitional housing that Delegate Brakeboy was talking about mm-hmm. and how to use that to do a grant program, if you will, to provide some stability to those victims or to our homelessness, to our veterans who need just that help and that leg up mm-hmm. For a 6-month, a year period, use the wraparound services that we have in Department of Social Services, but use those funds to help purchase those homes mm-hmm. and help them to get into the home for transitional housing, and hopefully that they'll be at a point 6 months from now, a year from now, to be able to become full homeowners. And what yeah. that does is solves two problems. Mm-hmm. First, it gives us a transitional housing that the people who are most vulnerable really need. Mm-hmm. And then second, it gets rid of the foreclosed homes that are on our books, and we're building our community one by one, block mm-hmm. by block, neighborhood by neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And so I think it really makes sense that we look into, and again, thinking a little bit differently about how we do. Yes, first-time home buyer programs are wonderful. We want to continue to do that for people who are trying to buy. Just like Mr. Stewart said, you know, he, you know, went from apartment to apartment growing up, but he decided to buy in his own community, and we do need to have those programs. But we've got a lot of vulnerable people that need to have good stability housing and have a place to go, a mm-hmm. place to be able to call home, a place to feel safe, mm-hmm. a place to, you know, feel in a welcomed community. And so definitely want to try to do something along those lines as your next councilwoman. But I can talk about a whole lot of issues. I know we've got a lot of candidates here today, but just wanted to touch base on that. You know, in terms of the food desert issue, it's not just an inside the Beltway community. I live in Clinton, Maryland, and the Giant in Clinton, Maryland closed down a number of years ago. It was in the former Clinton Plaza shopping center. It's now being redone as, quote-unquote, the Landing. But a lot of people do not realize that there are two senior apartments, Branchwood Towers yeah. and Clinton Manor, that are right behind that shopping center mm-hmm. where the Toys R Us is about to close as well, the Kmart closed. Those people have to traverse Branch Avenue. Some of them are in wheelchairs. Some of them are on walker strollers trying to get to the nearest grocery store, trying to get to the nearest CVS, trying to get to the nearest place where they can get their prescription medicine, where it's been closed for, I guess, several years now. Mm-hmm. And so it's a problem countywide that we need to make sure that when developers come and they build new communities and are proposing new communities, it's not just about density and housing. What are you providing? Are you going to build a new school? Are you going to widen the roads? Are you going to bring the economic development that makes sense for that area? Ms. Austin can tell you that she's here and has been a delegate. There's a law on the books in the state of Maryland that allows a developer to build a school in Prince George's County. It's never been used, mm-hmm. not once. And that's a crime. Because we have so many schools, particularly in District 9, that are older, that were built in the 60s and 70s that haven't been upgraded. They're still using old boiler systems, still using just old technology. And we don't have the 21st century schools that we really need. And so if you've got laws on the books that allow you to do certain things in terms of development and economic development, why aren't we using it? Why aren't we holding our developers accountable?
Absolutely.
To, you know, we want to give incentives to bring them here, mm-hmm. but we're not asking them to do anything to help us besides build all the houses, build all the apartment units and so forth. And so I really want to make sure that we hold the developers accountable of what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to pay what we call impact fees. The county council under this administration, under previous administrations, have given waivers. Mm-hmm. Impact fees, the money goes towards schools, roads, fire and public safety, fire, EMS, and police. If you're giving them waivers, that means you're not building a new fire station. Mm-hmm. That means you're not building a new police station. That means you're not adding new officers to the force. Mm-hmm. That also means that you're not building new schools. You're not improving the roads. And so if you're giving waivers all the time just to incentivize them to come, but they're not contributing to the development that's coming because they're going to bring new people. But bringing new people and bringing more housing development means that the county has to provide more services. Mm-hmm. And so we want to make sure we stop that. Number one, if you develop, you're going to pay. You're going to pay the impact fees. Exactly.
So is that what happened with MGM? Because they was looking for the money that MGM was supposed to be putting into the school system, but they never got the money.
Well, what has happened and what is supposed to be passing this year is a quote-unquote education fund lockbox that the money is not supposed to go to the general treasury and be used statewide for any and every purpose. So what generally happens is the state maintains the same level of funding. They never increase it, even though you're getting additional funding from gaming and from gambling. Mm-hmm. What they're doing is they're keeping the same formula and the same everything, the same amount. So the tax dollars that we were paying to go towards school is now being used to pay and fund other programs, other pet projects. Mm-hmm. And then the gaming money is just equaling what it was before. It's not in addition to. And that's what needs to stop. And that has to happen at the state level. Mm-hmm. And so the state is considering, from my understanding, they are considering making a quote-unquote lockbox for education funds. The teachers went up. They rallied in Annapolis to say, the education fund needs to be untouched. You put it designated for education and keep it there. And I support that wholeheartedly.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, they put to your point about the education fund, there's two parts that are kind of hidden that people don't know about. The fact that even though it's supposed to go to our education, we still have to share those funds with two other counties. So it doesn't just come to Prince George's County. So for the other casinos, if they lose funds, then MGM can make up that difference. So that's Arundel County. So if they lose money, then the money that would go into education for Prince George's County actually goes to funds those other
Does
counties.
Does that work the same with those counties?
No, it's a whole harmless clause. Yeah. And basically, what happened is that they wanted to make sure that they don't lose revenue because of the fact that MGM was built. So we have Maryland Live in Anne Arundel County, and then you have the Baltimore Casino Horseshoe.
Yes.
And so they knew that once MGM was built, there's a possibility that they would lose the gamblers that would come to their casinos to MGM. And so, unfortunately, the whole harmless clause does not have a sunset provision, meaning it needs to, you know, we can hold harmless for like maybe the first 3 years, the first 5 years, or what have you. That's something that the state legislature, again, has to fix. They have to say, okay, we've paid a whole harmless clause. MGM has paid a whole harmless clause. The county has given up money that could have been going to programs and education in Prince George's County. For this number of years, but now it's time to get off the pacifier and do whatever you need to do in order to continue to attract business for your casino.
So who oversees that?
Again, well, it's the Maryland Gaming Authority, but the legislation that was put in place was voted on by our own delegates as well as the entire delegation. But that was the fight in Annapolis. The fight in Annapolis was, well, if we're going to allow Prince George's County to build a new casino, they need to hold harmless us so that we don't lose revenue in terms of year-over-year revenue that they've. And so that's something that needs to definitely be addressed by our state delegation. Absolutely.
I feel like they also need to address, when you look at how much revenue is allocated to education, so you think it's the revenue off top. But it's not. It's based on, just to put out an example, let's say they have a certain type of slot machines at the front. Let's say they have 20. This is an arbitrary number. That means, and they have tables, they have everything else. They'll say, well, only these 20 slots, what the revenue we make off of this is the pool of funds that will go towards education. So most people think it's a pool off of revenue flat made by the casino, but it's not. Mm. It's based on allocated funds for certain gaming machines, but there's not a cap. There's nothing to say that they can't reduce the number. So they reduce the number of those particular types of slots after they open.
Wow.
So there's all of these provisions and loopholes that most people don't know about when they're talking about education and the funds and where they go and who's getting it.
Well, you know what?
Yeah. It's frustrating, so, I know.
And I'm the first one to go to a casino, okay? I'll tell you. I don't mind going to Maryland Live when I can, and when I can go, I don't mind going. But I voted against MGM. But I voted against MGM because I saw what, I saw future, right? You can't put something of such addiction into a community of already middle income. I know we're the richest county, but to be honest, we're still struggling in a lot of ways. And the area that they put it in, and you can't put something like that in that area and think that the people around it and the community around it are going to thrive. Mm-hmm. It's just not going to work. I see where they were going with it. Mm-hmm. Of course we would want something that beautiful, that pretty, that attraction, and we would want that type of money to be able to come into the county. I saw it. I was like, it's a joke. Yeah. Their education, get out of here. Yeah, I saw it. You know what I mean? And then to know that, you know, it was so many under the line, under the curtain things that they could do, you know, it's just disheartening because now we have this fancy MGM here, and already I have a coworker right now who lost her car and had to end up moving back in with her mother. Because, of course, she was one of those gamblers that would travel to, like, Charlestown. She would travel to Dover. But guess what? You can't get there every weekend, right? You can't get there every other weekend, right? You had to go when there were bus trips, and you had to go when you had the money.
Right.
Well, now, mm-hmm. I'm going to go ahead and take this $40. As a matter of fact, I'm going to wait on the car note. I'm going to go ahead and go. And see, you have to be careful. You know what I mean? When you put that type of establishment in this type of area, you know, I think I'm such a conspiracy theorist. But, I mean, I understand where it could have gone. Mm-hmm. But just like with the stadium, my grandparents were one of the ones when Don Juan was the mayor fighting against the stadium. I didn't want the stadium either. I don't see where it was a benefit for our community. Where? Half the babies in the community have never even been to a game. Half of them have seen the stadium. Most of them have seen it, but they've never stepped foot in it. Mm-hmm. And when they do step foot in it, it's always because they're doing something maybe locally for the community, but it's not for a game. Every once in a while, because every once in a while, they'll give tickets to an organization and they'll say, oh, bring the kids to the game. Every once in a while. Don't let them be doing good. They not getting tickets to nothing. Now, if they're doing bad, everybody's getting tickets. Everybody, right? Everybody, every organization is going to get tickets. Everybody's going to get their little incentives, right? But if the Washington Redskins are doing great, who's going to get tickets? Mm-hmm. Ain't nobody getting tickets. Those poor little babies over there in Palmer Park not going to get no tickets. You know what I mean? So we have to be informed about what's going on in our community. Like we were talking about zoning and all that kind of stuff. We have to be informed about what's going on and what's getting ready to be built across the street. And is this going to be beneficial to the community?
Right. Mm-hmm. Let me jump in, because I was actually in Annapolis when we voted on the gaming legislation, mm-hmm. and my church was fighting the stadium when mm-hmm. that was coming, because our church had just purchased that land and we didn't necessarily want to be in the front yard or backyard of the stadium. And one of the things that I've noticed, I'm Tiffany Austin, by the way, I'm running for state senate for the 24th legislative district. But I just couldn't sit here any longer and not say anything, because I think one of the problems that we suffer with as a county is that we continuously elect people who don't know how to negotiate, mm-hmm. who don't mm-hmm. understand the policies mm-hmm. and the rules of procedure that are going to be addressed. And for example, the incumbent in my race once was quoted in the Washington Post in saying that to bring gaming and gambling into our county is like putting a pile of cocaine in the middle of our district. Mm. Okay, and to an extent, I actually agree with her because it's highly addictive. Mm-hmm. And we know it's highly addictive because when we were being briefed by the legislators and by the gaming industry in the opposition, they told us how addictive it was. And you can call around and look around at other states and see how addictive it is. Exactly. And so one of the arguments I had was that, number one, this isn't how you balance a budget. You don't balance a budget on the social ills of people because it just brings about more problems and it costs us more money in the long run. And when you look around the country, wherever they've tried gaming, it hasn't worked. It didn't work in New Jersey. No, it's not working in Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work in New Orleans, and it doesn't work in Mississippi. So I ask, can you point to one place in the United States where they've implemented gaming and it's actually been a success, where it's actually benefited our community, and you couldn't find a place? And what concerned me the most about the incumbent in my race is, you know, she would say these things about how bad it was, but then when it was time to vote, she actually voted in favor of it. Mm. I was one of, I think, three members of the Prince George's County delegation that stood up against the powers that be and voted against it. I voted against it because it was a bad deal. It was a very bad deal. Not only was there the hold harmless provision, there was also the money to subsidize Rosecroft Raceway and the rest of the horse racing industry. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We had to fight to get money in for addictions treatment. Yeah. And we fought to get money in for developmentally disabled people because we knew that once we passed this bill, the pot of money would continue to shrink and to continue to shrink. Mm. And so when people say, oh, we voted for it because the money was going to education, I say you're lying. Or what's the young lady say? I call BS. Because it's BS. Like, either you're ignorant or you weren't paying attention or you forgot what you read. Totally. Because they were very clear in what the intentions were. The bill was explicitly clear in what was going to happen with the money. So any legislator that tells you that, oh, I just thought it was going to education or I thought this, they're lying. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have to get to a point in our community where we can call a spade a spade.
That's right.
And we can call a liar a liar. Mm-hmm. And where we stop accepting that as being okay, because it's not okay to tell us that giving us gaming is like putting cocaine in our community, and then you vote in favor of it. Do you want us all to get high on crack? I mean, what exactly is the message that you're sending? And so from my perspective, I believe that we need to have people that are not only capable of fighting and not only capable of talking a good game, but who are willing to stand up and fight the good fight when we need it fought the most. And it's at times like that when it comes to gaming that we need to fight. We have a major redistricting that's going to come up, and that's not a sexy topic. It's not fun to talk about. It's probably one of the most boring things we deal with in Annapolis, but it is the most important issue that's facing us, because when we do redistricting, we're looking at our ability to elect people of our own choosing. And the way these maps are drawn with gerrymandering, it allows the party that's in power to create seats that benefit them. And so because of that, we have great candidates like Ms. Davis Brown, who was actually drawn out of her district during the last redistricting race because a certain person didn't want to have to run against her. And so when we have powerful women and powerful women of color, we cannot allow the powers that be to draw them out of their district because they simply don't want the fight. And that has happened far too often. It essentially happened with Delegate Brave Boy. She led the charge in redistricting, and they drew her base out of her district. And so, you know, good for her. She's running for something that's now countywide. And so what we have to do is we have to start uniting and standing up to these policies that are normally being pushed by the Democratic Party. And I'm a Democrat, and I'm a proud Democrat, and I'm not going anywhere. But I'm also not going to allow the party to continue to use our votes, not give us anything in return, and expect us to shut up, sit down, and wait our turn. Those days are over.
Yes,
they are. It's time for us to reclaim our time. It's time for us to speak up, and it's time for us to take back the power that we rightfully own in this county.
It's time for a change.
So as we talk about all of the things that become the social ills, the foreclosure, the gaming, the gambling, those things eventually are going to touch those families. When they touch those families, then they're at the courthouse. And so as I said earlier, when people come to the courthouse, they're at the very vulnerable times of their lives.
That's right.
So you understand how it all comes together. It does.
It does.
And so by the time it gets to that point, it's usually too late. But on the front end, if we have people like Ms. Davis Brown and Ms. Austin standing up and doing those things that are important in our communities, then the less we'll have to deal in the court system. The court system is a very important entity. But we don't want to force people to have to be in a courthouse. We just don't.
That's true.
We have had an awesome conversation here today.
Yes, we have. Yes, we
definitely have to continue this. What you think?
We do. We're definitely going to bring you guys back on. We definitely want to be able to give you a platform to be able to reach, you know, the voters of Prince George's County. Because a lot of people in the community do not know what local government and what they do. And a lot of times when they go, they only show up every 4 years. And then everything that falls under the president is eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Or can I pronounce this name? And and who is this? Or I like the picture. You know, you never know what judgment they're making to do that. But it's very important for us to get involved in our local. Our local elections. We have to know the people that's going down to Annapolis that's standing up for us, and also to know what their platform and what they stand on, and to hold them accountable. It's definitely time to hold people accountable.
And that goes beyond the voting book. You got to show up at your PTA meeting. You got to show up at your civic association meeting, your homeowners association meeting. All of those meetings, because that's where the rubber really meets the road. They say all politics is local. It's local for a reason. I tell people, I was like, how many of you last year found out 1 week, you just woke up and found out the trash collection went from twice a week to once a week. Didn't know that the county council had voted on that. What happened? Nobody asked you your opinion. Exactly. I mean, and we feel like we get so little for our services. So trash collection, you know, when you take it from twice a week to once a week, it's noticeable. It's noticeable. We see it.
I missed it with the weather. Last Wednesday. And now I'm sitting with a bunch of trash because I missed it. And then Thursday, I don't they must have come out Thursday.
And so what we need is more transparency in government. And one of the things that I put on my campaign literature talks about good governance. But what it really means is that we're here to serve you. And as your next county councilwoman for District 9, I'm going to tell you what we're voting on every week. These are the issues that we're looking at to legislate. This is how I feel as your elected person to represent you. These are the issues, these are the things, these are the decisions that I'm leaning towards. But I want to hear from you. What do you say? What's your opinion about this? So that you're not surprised. And so that you know how, and that's a government of the people, by the people, and for the people.
That's right.
Because we're keeping you apprised of what's going on. You don't wake up in the next day and say, oh, I didn't know they changed the trash collection twice a week or once a week. And it doesn't do any good because we've had some surveys after the fact. Don't send me a survey after the fact. Don't send me a survey after you've made a decision about what's affecting me every day. And you know, I use that as a small example, but it was a big outcry afterwards. Like nobody, and I won't say nobody knew, but if you weren't in the know, if you weren't attending, that's why I say holding people accountable by going to your HOA meetings, your civic association meeting, your school board meetings. Go to Annapolis when they have their bill hearings in December. Go. A lot of times I can't go, but I guarantee you every last one of them got a letter or an email from me. And I read all the bills. I told them what I liked and what I didn't like, why I liked it or why I didn't like it, or how we can compromise and come up with a better solution that helps everybody, that is beneficial to the entire county. And we have to do that. And I know, you know, people are so bogged down, they're working two and three jobs, but you got to take the time out to engage after the ballot. You just can't go and say, oh, I did my civic duty, I voted. No, there's a lot
there's so much more to that.
Absolutely.
And I am definitely one of the biggest advocates for getting involved Mm-hmm. Even as when I was renting in the county, I went to Civic Association meetings just because I just wanted to know what was going on. Mm-hmm. But you have to make the time. I remember in my daughter's dance school one time, the parents were sitting around and all of the mothers were sitting around and they were talking about the private schools that their daughters were attending. Mm-hmm. And of course, my daughter was in public school and mm-hmm. I was like, oh, that's nice. Mm-hmm. That's nice. I said, well, how many PTA meetings do you go to? Do you all have a parent association? Girl, you know I don't have time for that. I said, well, sweetie, you might as well be in a public school. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you just send them to private school. It doesn't make any difference. You still have to get involved. Mm-hmm. You still have to be involved. Mm-hmm. And then especially if you're paying big top mm-hmm. dollar, you better be involved. Mm-hmm. Heck, I'm going to be there. As a matter of fact, I might be there every day.
If I'm in the community, I'm going to change.
I need to be there every day. Yeah. So, so we have to get involved.
Yeah, and you touched on it when you said about accountability for everyone. And being a millennial sometimes, I feel I keep my generation accountable because I feel like sometimes we're complacent and we're lazy and we're just not present on what's going on. Mm-hmm. And I feel like we all have to show up. Mm-hmm. One person can't carry us all the way. Mm-hmm. And so one of the staples for my campaign is that I can only promise to show up, that I will be present. Mm-hmm. But if you don't show up, there's only so much that we can do because mm-hmm. we both have to be at the table. And I think you saw what that led to with our last election. Mm-hmm. I think the masses saw it.
Yeah.
So people that usually don't pay attention or don't understand and say it doesn't matter, my vote's irrelevant. Like, we truly saw what being apathetic meant and what those results could look like.
What it could, yeah.
And I had to even take a step back because I was a fellow for the Hillary campaign, so I would drive to Pennsylvania every weekend. And so when I would call people to ask if they could come, mind you, I worked a full-time job too, and I still did it, and I'd ask people my age if they would come out. They're too tired. They're going out. That's not a priority for them. Mm-hmm. I remember the last day I was canvassing, because I canvassed actually even Pennsylvania the night of the election. I was canvassing with someone that was 80 years old. I literally would have to drive my car, park from house to house so she could walk up because it was a long driveway. Oh. But we still did it. Mm-hmm. But the people my own age would not show up mm-hmm. because they're too tired from partying because that's their priority. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that we have to, yes, we want to hold the elected officials accountable, but we also have to hold ourselves yeah. accountable just as citizens that have not been checked in because we've been apathetic and not caring about what's going on. Because a lot of times we live in a bubble and you feel like, well, I'm okay. I'm not feeling any oppression. Yeah. I'm not feeling downtrodden or losing a job or going through any struggle, so you don't understand what other people are going through. But for me, I don't know if it's because I've been part of a marginalized community in every facet my entire life, that I've never felt the ease of not fighting for equality. Mm-hmm. I've never felt what that feels like to just feel that you can walk into a room and be okay. Mm-hmm. I'm an openly gay Black woman from the South. Mm-hmm. And so everywhere I go, first generation American on my dad's side, there's a problem with the way I look, there's a problem with my name, there's a problem with me and my wife, there's a problem with something in some way, in some space. And I feel like some people just take the rights that they're given so freely for granted. Mm-hmm. And we have to all show up and fight for each other. And that's why I fight for people that don't even agree with me. They might hate everything about me, but I'll still fight for you. Right. Because I understand that you deserve a place to live. You deserve a quality education. You deserve to feel safe. You deserve quality food. And we just need to understand the intersectionality of all of our rights, because they want us all to be divided.
That's what they want.
Things mm-hmm. that don't matter.
That don't matter. Mm-hmm.
That don't right. matter at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because we don't have to agree on everything.
Right.
But I know if we have a lens of love, respect, and compassion, we can get a lot done.
Right. Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. I was this just getting ready to say that because we were running out of time, we wanted to give everybody an opportunity to be able to let our listeners know of why they should vote for you and also to be able to give your contact information out sure. so they can follow you. So since she already did her, she did her spiel, Crystal, so we'll go ahead and start with you, Bonita. You can go next.
I ask for your vote. I ask for your support because, as I stated earlier, I run on my experience, my compassion, and my knowledge of what it is it takes to be a professional, experienced clerk that can give the citizens of Prince George's County the type of professional service that they deserve. as taxpaying citizens, Prince George's County citizens deserve the best service. And that, as your clerk, is what I will strive to provide.
Absolutely. How can they follow, how can they catch up with you? Are you on social media?
I am. Okay. I'm on Facebook, brabelais@facebook.com. I'm on Twitter, brabelais is my Twitter handle. And I also have a crowd pack, Benita Rabelais. If you go to crowd pack and put in my name, you'll be able to donate online. And I ask that you, at the sound of my voice, that you run and do that now.
Yes, go and do that now. Make those donations.
Well, Tara? Sure. Well, my campaign slogan is integrity, leadership, and results. And I think someone said earlier, and I think it was Crystal, that says, look at the track record of the person. If you look at the track record of a person, you know what they've done in the past, you know what they're going to probably do in the future. Mm-hmm. And I've been an advocate for the community, like I said, almost 2 decades now. I have a regular job. I'm married. I have 2 grown children. My son's a sophomore at Hampton University now. My daughter's about to graduate from high school. Despite having raised children and being married and being a full-time attorney, I'm also a graduate of Howard Law School. besides that, I still took the time to be active and engaged in my community for decades. And so like I said earlier, what distinguishes me from the other candidates is that I've been active in working, fighting with and for the community and getting results for the community that I lived in. I've been living in Clinton since 1988, well, actually 1993. I lived in Fort Washington and in Accokeek for a little bit, but still in that District 9 area where I'm seeking office since 1988, but been active and involved. And so you look at my track record, you look at the track. I'm not just a Johnny Come Lately because it's an mm-hmm. open seat. Mm-hmm. I'm not a person who is seeking to do another career move just because there's an open seat. I've been involved. I've attended the Civic Association meetings. I've attended the school board meetings. I've been fighting for and with the community for decades, and that is what distinguishes me. People can reach me. I have a website, TamaraDavisBrown.org. I'm also on Facebook at Tamara Davis Brown. Personally, it's just Tamara Brown, and I'm also on Instagram and Twitter, Tamara D. Brown, as well. So awesome. All of those. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Tiffany.
Well, I'm Tiffany Austin. I'm running for State Senate in the 24th Legislative District. You can find me on Facebook at Tiffany Austin 24. Same handle for Twitter and whatever other social media I have. It's all Tiffany Austin 24. And my website is tiffanyaustin.org. I'm running for State Senate because I believe that we deserve better in our county. And, I was raised with very simple sayings. And one was, sweetie, if you're not part of the solution, mm-hmm. then you're part of the problem.
That's right.
And right now, the incumbent in my race is part of the problem. She's voted for things knowing that they were bad. She took a walk on one of the most important pieces of legislation of our time, the same-sex marriage bill. I was a freshman delegate, and I took a beating over that bill. And I would take it again because it was an important piece of legislation that our county needed to debate, that we needed to debate as a country. I said the Supreme Court needed to make that decision, and thank God they did, because that's who should make it. We shouldn't have the majority deciding rights for minorities. And we need to make sure that when we're dealing with politics, that we do so openly and with integrity. And I just don't believe that our current leadership has done that. And so I don't want to be part of the problem. I want to be part of the solution. And what I say is that if you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, then stop and make a change. And that's why I'm running, because I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm tired of our services being cut. I'm tired of being asked to pay more taxes and getting less services. Mm-hmm. I'm tired of bad bills coming through and people saying there was nothing that could be done. I know what could be done. I'm a proven fighter. I've put my life on the line literally and figuratively for what I believe in, and I believe that this is the best state and the best county in Maryland, and I'm going to fight for you. So I ask for your vote on June 26th, mm-hmm. And early voting is June 14th through the 22nd. I'm Tiffany Austin. I'm running for State Senate, and I hope I can count on your support. And then if I could do a quick little plug, I'm doing a Good Friday Fish Fry fundraiser so you can give some money on Good Friday. I can't say all that. Say you heard it on Vox, and we'll give you a discount.
Yes, time for change. Give you a discount. Right. Okay, and also, Crystal, just want to throw her website out there.
So you can reach me at www.votecrystalorietta.com, and I will spell that, KrystaL, last name, Orietta, O-R-I-A, D as in David, H-A.com. And then also social media, votecrystalorietta.com for Facebook, and you can also find me on Twitter and Instagram. And I just want to end with my slogan is demand better, do better, but then also that I'm not a politician, I'm an activist, an advocate, and I plan on doing that if elected to County Council for District 7. So thank you again for having me. It's been
thank you for coming. Okay. I appreciate you all. Thank you for coming. We ran out
of time. We are out of time.
We are out of time. Yes. So thank you. We will see you next Monday here at VoxWave.com with Time for a Change.
Thank you for joining us.
Bye. We ran over.